Chapter 5. The Crystal Palace. About 9 o'clock next morning, Mr. Saltina stood, bag in hand, in the ancestral hall, waiting for the vehicle to convey him to the station. Bernard Clark and Ethel were seated side by side on a costly sofa, gazing abstractly at the parting guest. Horace had dashed off to put on his cocked hat, as he was going in the barouche, but Francis Minnit was roaming about the hall well prepared for any deed. "Well," said Bernard, puffing at his meerschaum pipe, "I hope you will get on, Elf. I'm sure you have that little letter to old Clincham, eh?"
"Indeed I have," said Mr. Saltina. "Many thanks for the same, and I do hope Ethel will behave properly."
"Oh, yes, I expect she will," said Bernard, with a sigh.
"I always do,"
said Ethel in a snappy tone. Just then there was a great clatter outside and the sound of hoofs and a loud neigh. "The barouche, I take it," said Bernard, rising slowly. "Quite correct, sir," said Minnit, flinging wide the portals. "Well, goodbye, Alf, old man," said Bernard Clark. "Good luck, and God bless you," he added, in a pious tone.
"Not at all," said Mr. Saltina. "I have enjoyed my stop, which has been short and sweet. Well, goodbye, Ethel, my child," he said,
as bag in hand he proceeded to the door. Francis Minnit bowed low and handed a small parcel to Mr. Saltina. "A few sandwiches for the journey, sir," he remarked.
"Oh, this is most kind," said Mr. Saltina.
Minnit closed his eyes with a tired smile. "Not kind, sir," he muttered. "Quite usual."
"Oh, really?"
said Mr. Saltina, feeling rather flabbergasted. "Well, goodbye, my good fellow." And he slipped 2 and 6 into the butler's open palm. Mr. Saltina had to travel first class, as active Horace ran on to buy the ticket, which he presented with a low bow of the Times and Titbits.
"Oh, many thanks, my man," said Mr. Saltina in a most airy voice. "Now you will find me a corner seat in the train, eh?"
"If there is one, sir," replied Horace. In got Mr. Saltina to his first-class carriage, surrounded by his luggage, carefully piled up by kindly Horace. The other passengers looked full of envy at the curly white wig and green plush uniform of Horace. Mr. Saltina crossed his legs in a lordly way and flung a fur rug over his knees, though he was hot enough in all conscience. He began to feel this was the thin end of the partition, and he smiled as he gently tapped the letter in his coat-tail pocket. When Mr. Saltina arrived in London, he began to stroll up the principal streets, thinking how gay all was. Presently, he beheld a restaurant with a big menu outside, and he went boldly in. It was a sumptuous spot, all done up in gold, with plenty of looking glasses. Many handsome ladies and gentlemen were already partaking of choice food and rich wines and whiskey, and the scene was most lively. Mr. Saltina had a little whiskey to make him feel more at home. Then he eat some curry to the tune of a merry valse on the band. He beat time to the music and smiled kindly at the waiters, and he felt very excited inside.
"I'm seeing life with a vengeance," he muttered to himself, as he paid his bill at the desk.
Outside, Mr. Saltina found a tall policeman.
"Could you direct me to the Crystal Palace, if you please?"
said Mr. Saltina, very nervously. "Well," said the genial policeman, "my advice will be to take a cab, sir."
"Oh, would it?" said Mr. Saltina. "Then I will do so."
He hailed a hansom and got speedily in.
"To the Crystal Palace," he cried gaily,
and holding his bag on his knees, he prepared to enjoy the sights of the metropolis. It was a merry drive, and all too soon the palace heaved in view. Mr. Saltina sprang out and paid the man, and then he entered the wondrous edifice. His heart beat very fast as two huge men in gold braid flung open the doors. Inside was a lovely fountain in the middle, and all round were little stalls where you could buy sweets and lemonade, also scent handkerchiefs, and many dainty articles. There were a lot of people, but nobody very notable. At last, after buying 2 bottles of scent and some rather nice sweets which stuck to his teeth, Mr. Saltina beheld a wooden door on which was nailed a notice saying, "To the private compartments."
"Aha," said Mr. Saltina to himself, "this is evidently my next move," and he gently pushed open the door, straightening his top hat as he did so.
Inside, he found himself in a dimly lit passage with a thick and handsome carpet. Mr. Saltina gazed round and beheld in the gloom a very superior gentleman in full evening dress who was reading a newspaper and warming his hands on the hot water pipes. Mr. Saltina advanced on tiptoe and coughed gently, as so far the gentleman had paid no attention. However, at the second cough, he raised his eyes in a weary fashion. "Do you want anything?" he asked in a most noble voice. Mr. Saltina got very flustered.
"Well, I am seeking the Earl of Clincham," he began in a trembly voice. "Are you by any chance him?" he added most respectfully.
"No, not exactly," replied the other. "My name happens to be Edward Procurio. I am half Italian, and I am the groom of the chambers.
What chambers?
Asked Mr. Saltina, blinking his eyes.
These, said Edward Procurio, waving a thin arm.
Mr. Saltina then noticed several red doors with names of people on each one.
Oh, I see, he said. Then perhaps you can tell me where the Earl of Clincham is to be found.
At the end of the passage, fourth door down, said Procurio tritely. Of course, he may be out. One never knows what they are up to.
I suppose not, said Mr. Saltina in an interested tone.
One cannot gamble on anything, really, said Procurio, returning to the hot water pipes. Though, of course, I know a lot more than most people about the inmates here.
What are the habits of the Earl of Clincham?
Said Mr. Saltina.
Procurio gave a smile. Many and various, he replied. I can't say much in my position, but one lives and learns.
He heaved a sigh and shrugged his shoulders.
Well, good day, said Mr. Saltina, feeling better for the chat.
Procurio nodded in silence as Mr. Saltina trotted off down the passage. At last he came to a door labelled Clincham, Earl of, in big letters. With a beating heart, Mr. Saltina pulled the bell and the door swung open of its own accord. At the same moment, a cheery voice rang out from the distance. Come in, please! I'm in the study! First door on left! With a nervous bound, Mr. Saltina obeyed these directions and found himself in a small but handsome compartment, done in dark green leather, with crests on the chairs. Over the mantelpiece was hung the painting of a lady in a low neck, looking quite the thing. By the desk was seated a tall man of 35, with very nice eyes, of a twinkly nature, and curly hair. He wore a quite plain suit of palest grey, but well made, and on the table reposed a grey top hat, which had evidently been on his head recently. He had a rose in his buttonhole, also a signet ring. Hello, said this pleasant fellow, as Mr. Saltina was spellbound on mat.
Hello, your lordship, responded our hero, bowing low and dropping his top hat. Do I address the Earl of Clincham?
You do, said the Earl, with a homely smile. And who do I address, eh? Our hero bowed again.
Alfred Saltina, he said, in deep tones.
Oh, I see, said the kindly Earl. Well, come in, my man, and tell me who you are. Mr. Saltina seated himself gingerly on the edge of a crested chair.
To tell you the truth, my lord, I am not anyone of import, and I am not a gentleman, as they say.
He ended getting very red and hot. Have some whiskey, said Lord Clincham, and he poured the liquid into a glass at his elbow. Mr. Saltina lapped it up thankfully. Well, my man, said the good-natured Earl, what I say is, what does it matter? We can't all be of the blood royal, can we?
No, said Mr. Saltina, but I suppose you are.
Lord Clincham waved a careless hand. A small portion flows in my viands, he said, but it does not worry me at all. And after all, he added piously, at the day of judgment, what'll be the odds? Mr. Saltina heaved a sigh.
I was thinking of this world, he said.
Oh, I see, said the Earl, but my own idea is that these things are as piffle before the wind.
Not being an earl, I can't say, answered our hero. But may I beg you to read this letter, my lord?
He produced Bernard's note from his coat-tails. The Earl of Clincham took it in his long fingers. This is what he read. My dear Clincham, the bearer of this letter is an old friend of mine, not quite the right side of the blanket, as they say. In fact, he is the son of a first-rate butcher, but his mother was a decent family called Hyssops of the Glen. So, you see, he is not so bad and is desirous of being the correct article. Could you rub him up a bit in society ways? I don't know much details about him, but no doubt he will supply all you need. I'm keeping well and hope you are. I must run up to the compartments one day and look you up. Yours as ever, your faithful friend, Bernard Clark. The Earl gave a slight cough and gazed at Mr. Saltina thoughtfully. Have you much money, he asked, and are you prepared to spend a good deal?
Oh, yes, quite, gasped Mr. Saltina. I have plenty in the bank and £10 in ready gold in my purse.
You see, these compartments are the haunts of the aristocracy, said the Earl, and they are kept going by people who have got something funny in their family and who want to be less mere, if you can comprehend.
Indeed I can, said Mr. Saltina.
Personally, I'm a bit partial to mere people, said his lordship. But the point is that we charge a goodly sum for our training here. But however, if you can't pay, you need not join.
I can and will,
proclaimed Mr. Saltina, and he placed a £10 note on the desk. His lordship slipped it in his trouser pocket. It will be £42 before I have done with you, he said, but you can pay me here and there as convenient.
Oh, thank you, cried Mr. Saltina.
Not at all, said the Earl. And now to business.
While here, you will live in compartments in the basements known as lower range. You will get many hints from the groom of the chambers as to clothes and etiquette to menials. You will mix with me for grammar, and I might take you out hunting or shooting sometimes to give you a few tips. Also, I have lots of ladies' parties which you will attend occasionally.
Mr. Saltina's eyes flashed with excitement.
I shall enjoy that, he cried.
His lordship coughed loudly. You may not marry while under instruction, he said firmly.
Oh, I shall not need to, thank you, said Mr. Saltina.
You must also decide on a profession, said his lordship, as your instruction will vary according.
Could I be anything at Buckingham Palace?
Said Mr. Saltina, with flashing eyes. Oh, well, I don't quite know, said the noble earl, but you might perhaps gallop beside the royal barouche if you care to try.
Oh, indeed I should, cried Mr. Saltina. I am very fond of fresh air and royalties.
Well, said the earl with a knowing smile, I might arrange it with the Prince of Wales, who I am rather intimate with.
Not really, gasped Mr. Saltina.
Dear me, yes, remarked the earl carelessly, and if we decide for you to gallop by the royal vehicle, you must be measured for some plush knickerbockers at once! Mr. Saltina glanced at his rather fat legs and sighed. Well, I must go out now and call on a few dowagers, said his lordship, picking up his elegant top hat. Well, au revoir, he added, with a good French accent.
Adieu, my lord,
cried Mr. Saltina, not to be outdone.
We meet anon, I take it.
Not till tomorrow, answered the earl. You will now proceed to the lower regions, where you will no doubt find tea. He nodded kindly and glided out in silence.
Here I will end my chapter.